May remain standing for just a moment, and we're gonna ask our musicians to go ahead and come up, and we're gonna sing our first song. First song that you'll sing this morning is entitled "When God Dips His Love in My Heart." Speaking of the sacrifice that Christ made as He came as a human to the earth, but then, as we know and we celebrate this time of year through Easter, He gave His life upon the cross. And then the second song is "Glory to His Name." In all that we do, and when we think about all that Christ has done for us, the only true response that we should have is to give glory to Him. So as we go throughout today, and knowing that tonight is our communion service, let's pause today and let's give glory to God in everything that we do, through all of our thoughts, through all of our actions, through everything that happens in our life.
And as Brother Kevin said, our first one is "When God Dips His Love in My Heart." And let's hear the guys on those repeats in the chorus. Here we go. When God dips His pen of love in my heart and writes my soul a message He wants me to know, His Spirit all divine fills this sinful soul of mine. When God dips His love in my heart, well, I said I wouldn't tell it to a living soul how He brought salvation when He made me whole. But I find I couldn't hide such love as Jesus did impart. Laugh and it makes me cry, sets my sinful soul on fire. When God dips His love in my heart, sometimes though the way is dreary, dark, and cold, and some unburdened sorrow keeps me from the goal, I go to God in prayer. I can always find Him there to whisper sweet peace to my soul. Well, I said I wouldn't tell it to a living soul how He brought salvation when He made me whole. But I find I couldn't hide such love as Jesus did impart. Laugh and it makes me cry, sets my sinful soul on fire. When God dips His love in my heart, He walked every step up Calvary's rugged way to give His life completely and bring a better day. My life was steeped in sin, but in love He took me in. When God washed away every stain, well, I said I wouldn't tell it to a living soul how He brought salvation when He made me whole. But I find I couldn't hide such love as Jesus did impart. Laugh and it makes me cry, sets my sinful soul on fire. When God dips His love in my heart. You can be seated. All right, and our next hymn is "Glory to His Name." Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name. To my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. O precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to His name. Glory to His name, glory to His name, my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
I feel kind of nervous standing up here with Paul sitting out here watching me. You know, I feel like I'm being graded or something, maybe. I asked him if he wanted to lead, y'all, so he said in a year. So we'll hold you to that. Good to have you here, Paul and Ann. All right, and our last hymn is When I See the Blood. And we'll stand on the fourth verse, please.
Christ our Redeemer died on the cross, died for the sinner, paid all his due. All who receive him need never fear, for he will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Chiefest of sinners, Jesus can save. As he has promised, so will he do. Oh, sinner, hear him, trust in his word. Then he will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Judgment is coming, all will be there, who have rejected, who have refused. Oh, sinner, hasten, let Jesus in, then God will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Oh, what compassion, oh, boundless love, Jesus hath power, Jesus is true. All who believe are safe from the storm. Oh, he will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you.
Brother Freddie, would you lead us in prayer, please? Be seated. We have a treat this morning. We have a new duet, Maddie and Michael.
music this time, so that's already an improvement. So we chose this song, mostly because it's what our voices sound good on, but it has a really good message for Easter in that knowing that Christ is the only way that we can get to Him, that Christ is the only path we have to the Father. So if y'all worship with us as we sing.
Who, O Lord, could save themselves, their own soul could heal? Our shame was deeper than the sea, Your grace is deeper still. Who, O Lord, could save themselves, their own soul could heal? Our shame was deeper than the sea, Your grace is deeper still. And You alone can rescue, You alone can save, You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To You alone belongs the highest praise. You, O Lord, have made a way, the great divide You healed. For when our hearts were far away, Your love went further still. Yes, Your love goes further still, and You alone can rescue, You alone can save, You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To You alone belongs the highest praise. To You alone belongs the highest praise. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, You're the giver of life. And You alone can rescue, You alone can save, You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To You alone belongs the highest praise. To You alone belongs the highest praise. To You alone belongs the highest praise.
Just to, some of you are familiar with it, but give a little bit of a plug for Truth and Peace program that the Free Will Baptist denomination has. These two met at Truth and Peace 4 years ago. 4 years ago. And a year after they met, started dating. She's from Missouri, and
we're thankful that she has stuck it out. I ask her every time there's a few, and still ask if she's sure. And she used to give me a percentage. We're finally above 95%, I think. So, also, you know, to give some praise and glory to God. 4 years and 3 months ago, which was our first time to be with you, if you would have told me that Michael would be doing this, I would have probably argued with you. But God is able to do all things in all people. And a girl helps a lot too. But, you know, God can work miracles. And I'm thankful that Michael chose to listen. And I hope you will as well, as God works in all of our lives to continue to mature us and bring us along. And none of us are perfect. We won't get to that spot until we leave this world, and then it's only by the blood of Christ. So let's give glory and honor to him. If you would turn with me to Luke chapter 19 this morning. We're going to begin in verse 45. If you want to go ahead and flip there, we'll get there in just a moment. There was a comedian in Branson, I think, that would tell people as part of the show, just open your Bibles to wherever you want. Sooner or later, we'll get by there. We're actually just going to be in Luke chapter 19, but do want to share with you a little bit of history here in the United States. When Franklin Roosevelt was president, he had some connections with some of the large churches in and around Washington. But he chose to go to a smaller one by the name of St. John's Church. And it bothered him that tourists would attend a certain church simply because they wanted to be able to get a chance to see the president in church. There's a legendary story about a phone call that was made to the pastor of St. John's Church during the week, one week. And an individual called the church and he asked the pastor, "Will the president be in attendance at worship this Sunday?" To which the pastor replied, "I don't know if the president will be, but I can assure you that Jesus will, and that's enough." And you know, that should always be enough. That we come to church just because we know that it's our time we're going to set aside to worship the Lord. For the Jewish people in Old Testament times and beginning of New Testament, down through history, the temple had been a precious place to them. It was supposed to be a precious place to them. It was supposed to be where they would sacrifice to the Lord. It was where their mediator, the high priest, would actually talk to God for them, mediate for them. And it was a place that their life was supposed to be centered around. The temple was definitely a special place to Jesus, but in much different ways. Jesus' life and death and resurrection actually fulfilled the purpose of the temple that we think about in Old Testament. In the text that we're going to read in just a moment, we have Luke's recording of Jesus clearing out the temple of the money changers, and then in just a few short days, he would actually be arrested and crucified. Now, this is the second time that he would clear the temple. The purpose of the temple, as Jesus knew, at least the part of the temple that was called the Court of Gentiles, the purpose of that had drifted away from what it was supposed to be used for. It had lost its God-given purpose. It was supposed to be a place of evangelism, a place where those that were not Jewish people could come, they could hear about God, they could learn about how to commune with Him, and they could just learn to be by faith to believe in Him and to create this relationship with Him. That was the purpose of the Court of Gentiles. But it had drifted so far away from what it was supposed to be, it had lost its God-given purpose. We often think of the temple as being the place where sacrifices were made, and it was. But those sacrifices had a purpose as well. They were to enable individuals to be able to commune with God, to pray with God, as we often call it today. We talk about prayer and we talk about it's a conversation between us and God, and hopefully us allowing God to speak to us as well.
prayer's not a one-sided deal. It should be two. So when we think about in Old Testament times, when they would come to the temple, it was a place that they would come to actually speak to God because they had to have a high priest that would communicate to God for them. We have Jesus Christ, thankfully, right? That was really weak. Y'all need to know Christ, I'm telling you, okay? Thankfully, we have Jesus Christ today, right? Okay, that's better. In Jesus' time, though, the temple had become a place of business. And Jesus' intention on this day, the text that we're going to look at, was to bring the temple back to what it was originally supposed to be. That was a house of prayer. Notice the words in the text that we'll read when we read them. Notice the words. It says, "If you have made my house a den of thieves, but my house shall be a house of prayer." Now think about what that actually means. A house of prayer means a place where we commune or we speak to, we have conversation with God. That's why we come together here today, right? It's a place where we allow God's word to minister to our heart so that we can have that relationship with God, but we can also have that conversation with God so that He invests in our life, opens our eyes maybe to things that we did not understand before, but then also we can leave here with a better understanding of what God has called us to do. The entire purpose of the temple was for God's people to be able to talk to and commune with Him. It had become this place of business, though. Jesus said it's not going to be that. And we might liken this today, a similar situation, to someone who might read their Bible just so they could say that they've read it. The temple had become a place of formality, a place where people came because they were just supposed to do it. Society told them they were, in Jewish community I'm talking. Society told them they were supposed to. It had become a formality of what they'd done. Think about Bible reading today. Sometimes we get into this situation where we read our Bible because it's just kind of what we're supposed to do. We don't let it change us necessarily. We don't let it speak into our heart. We don't leave after reading the Bible being any different than what we were before we picked it up. So we go through the formality of it. This is similar to what was happening in the Old Testament time. We also might think of it as attending church. Sometimes we walk in church and we walk out exactly the same as we were before. Should that happen? Probably not. Because if we're listening to the Word of God, if we're allowing the Holy Spirit to minister our heart, no matter how bad the sermon is, we're concentrating on God's Word, not what some man says. We're concentrating on His Word. We're listening to the songs that we sing that should be giving praise unto God or reminding us of what Christ has done for us. And those things should resonate within our heart. We should leave here as a different person than what we were when we came, because God's Word does not return void. What seems to have happened in the old days was that the temple had become a place of formality. They came, they went, nothing changed. If we're not cautious as believers today, we pick up our Bible, we read, we lay it down, nothing changes. We walk into church, we listen, we sing the songs, we pray, we listen to a sermon, we have invitation, we get up, we walk out, and nothing about us changes. When that happens, understand that's not God's fault. But it's because we've lost what our intended purpose is supposed to be as believers in Christ. If we do not allow God's word to challenge our heart or give glory to God for all of His goodness, then what have we really done? So maybe today it would be valuable for us to ask ourselves, has the church of today or the people of God today lost their God-given purpose? The God-given purpose of the temple was for communion with God, a place where they could go. Those who are non-Jewish people could actually hear about God, evangelism, as we call it today. But those who were already believers, it was a place for them to go and have communion with God, just as though He was a friend. Do we come today realizing now, that I don't want to minimize this, because God is to be praised and glorified, but also we should realize that God is also our friend. I think it's worth us thinking through, in light of Jesus cleansing the temple, I think it's worth us thinking through the fundamental reason for this church existing, but also the fundamental reason for us saying that we are a believer in Christ. If we were to say that this is a place, this church is a place where sermons take place, where teaching happens, where potlucks happen, and where support for missionaries take place, where support for even the food backpack program exists, then all of those things are wonderful things. They're good, and I'm glad that they happen. But are they the reason that we fundamentally exist? You see, we can decide on our own whether we're saved or not to support a missionary. We can send money to any organization. We can also decide that we want to help in a backpack food program, regardless of whether we're saved or not. We can sing songs. You can flip your radio. It's a free nation, so still. You can flip your radio over to any Christian station. You can listen, sing along with them, learn them. You can do the same thing by listening to a sermon. You can even, whether you're saved or not, pick up the Bible and read it. So what's the difference between someone that is saved and someone that's not? The difference would be internally, that we allow God's Word, His message, to actually come within our heart and to change us from who we were to who we become. But if we don't allow that, then what are we really doing? We've lost the purpose of existing as a believer and a follower of Jesus Christ. This is the problem that was happening in the days when Jesus walks in the temple. And He says, "You've made my house a den of robbers, but it's supposed to be a house of prayer." Over the past year, many of the activities of the church have been scaled down or have been reduced. But hopefully through it all, we could say that it has continued to be a place where people can gather and connect with God. Even though we're not having the potlucks, and there's a great connection with God through a potluck, right? I love potlucks, by the way. What's the favorite or the best dessert? Y'all still remember, I'm glad. Potlucks are great. They're a great way for us to fellowship with each other. But if our heart has no connection to a church except because of a potluck, then we're really in the wrong place. Well, the past year, a lot of things have been scaled down, but hopefully we can say that this place has continued to be a place, as well as all other churches, continue to be a place where we can connect with God, we can allow Him to mature our heart, to grow our heart, convict us in times when we need it, and we can leave this place being different than what we were. And if that didn't happen over the last year, then we failed at what we were trying to do. Now, granted, a lot of that depends on us individually, right? Because if we don't come with that attitude and that mentality, then it's not going to happen no matter what we do. Looking at our text this morning, we must remember that the first commandment that was given in Old Testament was to love the Lord your God above all else. That's summarized, but to love the Lord above all else. And as we have church today, that should be the utmost of importance. That everything we do should center around us loving God more than anything else. Now, potluck can come second or third or wherever you want to put it. But it should never take the place of God, nor should any other activity within the church. And there's a lot of good activities that happen around all different kinds of churches. But God must be at the forefront of all of them. And if we've lost that, then we've lost what our intended purpose as a believer and follower of God should be. So we read our text this morning. Notice Jesus was determined that the temple would be this house of prayer, the place where people could connect and commune with God. He was returning the temple to its primary reason for existing. And I would ask you today, as we look at this text, is this our primary reason as a church but also as an individual for existing today, that we commune and we connect with God. Stand with me as we read our text, if you're able this morning. Luke chapter 19, verse 45 says, "And he entered the temple, and he began to drive out those who sold, saying to them, 'It is written, my house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers.' And he was teaching daily in the temple. The chief priests and the scribes and the principal men of the people were seeking to destroy him, but they did not find anything they could do, for all the people were hanging on his words." I want you to note those last four words. They were hanging on his words. Those words were the word of God. Today, whenever we pick up the Bible and we read, we should hang on the words of God. Pray with me if you will. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, thanking you for this time that we have. And Lord, as we are gathered here today, help our main focus, our main intention to be that we would place you first in our life, no matter what that would mean that we might need to do today. Lord, help us to keep you in the forefront of everything that we do. Lord, if there's conviction in our heart that needs to happen, we pray that we would be open and obedient to it. And we pray this in your Son's name, Jesus the Christ. Amen. You may be seated. I want you to notice three things with me in this passage of text that Jesus done for us by his actions here. First, notice Jesus, obviously, he cleansed the temple, but he not only cleansed it, he cleansed it for the Gentiles. The abuse that existed in the temple grew out of the worshipers' need to obtain unblemished animals for sacrifice. The annual requirement also for every male, Israelite male, to pay a half shekel temple tax, which had to be paid in a specific currency. So this would lead to the need for the money changers. You would come in with your currency that you had, you would go to an individual that would actually trade you for the correct currency that could be paid to the temple, and they would charge you this usury fee. We call it an exchange rate today. But they would charge you money in order for you to get the right currency to pay the temple tax. From what we understand, tremendous charges were being made. People were being taken advantage of. A large number of livestock were being sold for exorbitant prices, huge prices, so that people could purchase an animal for a sacrifice. Jewish history actually records for us that 3,000 livestock were brought to the temple to be sold for offerings during this week. 3,000 livestock that were brought. And in the minds and the hearts of those that were bringing the livestock was, we're fixing to make a killing, money-wise, on these animals that we're about to sell. Their heart was far from actually worshiping God. It was a religious scam. It had been going on for years. And specifically in the court of Gentiles is where this would occur. Now, this is a place in the temple where non-Jewish people were able to go and to hear about God. It was a place, supposed to be, a place of evangelism. It was a place that not only Jewish people could walk in, Gentile people could. They could come in, hear about God. They could ask questions. They could study. They could be taught. And they could actually leave, if they so desired, as a believer by faith in God. What was happening, though, is evangelism was a second, third, or fourth thought. And first and foremost in their mind was the money changers and selling the livestock, because they could make money doing it. It had become a place of business. It was not a place where they were passionately reaching the hearts of those who were lost. It was a place where they were making a dollar. Mark records this event with a little more detail and a little more passion, probably, than what we just read in Luke. Notice with me in Mark chapter 11. It'll be on your screen. It says, "And they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who sold and those who bought in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeons. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. And he was teaching them and saying to them, Is it not written, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations? But you have made it a den of robbers. I want you to notice the passion that Jesus has in this passage. He cleansed the temple, but he cleansed it for a reason, so that those who wanted to commune with God would have the opportunity. And not just Jewish people. Notice as Mark recorded, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations. You see, Jesus cleansed the temple not just for Jewish people. He cleansed it for you and I, those who are not Jewish. That's extremely important, because the temple was originally designed for those who were of the Israelite nation, Jewish. They had this court of Gentiles. It was a place of evangelism, but Christ has now come in and said, everything else is going out the door. This is a place where evangelism is going to occur, because all the nations need to hear about my Father, God. Mark records it, not just for the Jews, but a place for everyone to be able to hear. Which then brings us to our second point, where Jesus commandeered, or he made functional, the temple for us. It was supposed to be a place of evangelism. No one was to be excluded. No matter what nation, nationality they were, no one was to be excluded. They were to be welcome to learn about the God of creation. Isaiah listed it this way in chapter 56. And the foreigners, those who were not Jewish, who joined themselves to the Lord to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it and holds fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain. Holy mountain, by the way, is where the temple was. And make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings, their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Jesus attacked the teaching and the lifestyle of the Jews that had excluded the Gentiles from the opportunity of knowing the grace of God, the place where all people could commune with God. That had been prevented from happening to anyone other than Jew. Jesus cleansed this temple for two reasons. First, to honor God in his name, and secondly, so that the salvation of sinners could continue. We must be thankful today that Jesus cleansed this temple, because by his actions, what it showed was that he had a desire and a passion to see you and I come to know him today. Jesus' statement of "you have made it a den of robbers" is actually a reference to Jeremiah chapter 7, where Jeremiah is warning Israel that they cannot be a people that go and continue to do sinful things and then just go to the temple and make a sacrifice and everything be okay. Notice Jeremiah chapter 7. It says, will you steal, murder, commit adultery, swear falsely, make offerings to Baal, and go after other gods that you have not known? And then come and stand before me in the house, which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered, only to go and do all these abominations. In other words, are you really going to go out and live this earthly life that's full of sin and then walk into my house and say, by the grace of God, you have delivered me, and then turn around and walk back out into the world and do all of those things all over again, and then come in again a few days later and say, by the grace of God, you've delivered me? Jeremiah is saying this is not the way our relationship with God is supposed to be. Nor is it supposed to be that way today. But do you see this occurring today? Sadly, yes. You see, if this is what's going on in our lives today, then we have missed Jesus' warning that exists here in this passage of text. And that warning is that if we imagine our association with the things of God makes everything good between us and God, then we have missed what Jeremiah was sharing. You see, such an idea that if I go to church, then I'm okay. Or if I associate with God's people, then I'm okay. Or if I become part of a church, then I'm okay. That line of thought will send us straight to an eternity in hell. That's not the relationship that God was looking for. God was looking for people who would commune with Him, who would take up and place in their heart the desires that God had for us when He first created us back in the Garden of Eden. Paul gave a warning to the Jews in Romans chapter 2. He said, "For no one is a Jew who is merely one outward, nor is circumcision outward and physical, but a Jew is one inwardly. And circumcision is a matter of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the letter. His praise is not from man, but it is from God." That praise comes when we inwardly are changed by the Word of God because we commune with God. And then our outward actions becomes a reflection of what the inward has changed to. You see, we can't be followers of Christ just outwardly. We must have an inward change that overflows to an outward action that is much different. Jesus cleansed the temple so that we could see that God would not tolerate the den of robbers, but that access to God was for all and must be pure in heart, not for personal gain, not for the advance of our own agendas, but so that we could have a relationship with the Father. I want you to also notice, if you go back to that passage in Mark chapter 11, in verse 16, it says, "And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple." Now that seems maybe a little bit confusing as to wondering why it would be wrong to carry something through the temple. But when you know what was actually going on, it makes a little more sense. The temple was a huge place, by the way. What was going on is people would come in one side of the temple. They were actually needing to go to what was on the other side of the temple. But instead of walking around it, they would walk in one side and walk out the other. Their intention was not, "I'm going into the temple to have a relationship with God." Their intention was, "I need to get to that place over there, so I'm going to walk through the temple because it's shorter and I don't have to walk as much." Their heart was nowhere close to what it was supposed to be when they come in the temple or the residence at that point in time of God on earth. I want to ask you today, flipping the narrative a little bit, do we ever use church as a place to walk through today? Here's what I mean by that. Saturday evening or Sunday morning, we get up and we understand that we have some things that we have to do this afternoon, Sunday afternoon. But we also know, you know, it'd be really good if I went to church. So we go to church, but our heart is nowhere near it because our heart is on, "I've got these things I got to do this afternoon." So we pass through church, giving that hour, 2 hours, whatever it is, we pass through church with nothing about God on our mind because we're focused on what's on the other side. And so we walk through it and nothing is accomplished. When Christ says, or when Mark records, that Jesus would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple, understand that Jesus' heart was that everyone that entered the temple would have the mindset that they came to worship and commune with God. Which should also be our mindset when we enter into a worship time, whether it's on Sunday morning, Saturday evening, Wednesday evening, you pick the time. If you're coming together for the purpose of worshiping God, then our hearts should be focused upon that and not upon what needs to happen later today. Otherwise, we're just walking through and it's become a formality in our life. Thirdly, this morning, Jesus was actually showing what he would soon do on the cross by making grace truly available to all and out of the control of those who had made his house a den of thieves. And by doing that, Jesus became what we might term the temple for us today. And I would like to say that we really need to be thankful that Jesus is our modern day temple. If you ever go back and study everything that had to occur in Old Testament times, that alone should make us thankful for Jesus Christ. But understanding what Jesus done for us by giving his body and his blood should increase that praise that we should have for him tremendously. It is through him that we can have communion with God without going to an earthly high priest. Hebrews tells us he is our great high priest that's making intercession for us. In Hebrews chapter 4, it says, since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. But we have one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. You see, the temple was the old covenant way for us to commune with God, but today, Jesus is our way of communing. We must be thankful for this new, what we might term, temple that we have through Jesus Christ, high priest as he is. John records for us in chapter 1, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. I want to take you back to a word that's in that text where it says dwelt among us. That word dwelt in the original Greek actually means tabernacled among us. He is the temple among us. Jesus became this. He is the one that allows us to be able to speak with God directly. We don't have to have a high priest. We don't have to have anyone to make intercession or mediate for us. All we need is to turn to Jesus Christ. You might remember studying or looking at pictures of how beautifully the temple was built or decorated, if you want to call it that. It was, to just look at it, you might say it was a glorious building by the way it was built and decorated. But as we think about Christ, Christ is so much more than what the temple ever was. From an outward appearance, he would look, while walking upon the earth, he would look no more than just a mere man. But in what he accomplished and what he done, it was so much more than that. He is the very presence of God that came and lived upon this earth, walked with those who were able to be with him. In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3, it says, he is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature. If you saw God in the way he reacts, if you read his actions, his word, you saw God. That's who he was. That's who he is. He is the only access to God. In John chapter 14, we find, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. He is our atoning sacrifice. If you remember in Old Testament times, they had to offer sacrifices over and over and over again. It didn't wipe away the debt of sin that they had. It simply would roll it forward. They still had that sin in their life. But Jesus became our atoning sacrifice. He himself, in 1 Peter chapter 2, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. He was our mediator, is our mediator between God and man. In Hebrews chapter 6, it says, we have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place beyond the curtain, or behind the curtain, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest, listen, not just in his lifetime, because if you remember, high priest served for a certain number of years, and then a new high priest would come into play. They would die, then new high priest would come. But notice what Hebrews 6 says. Having become a high priest forever, no matter how long this earth exists, we don't know when Christ is going to return. We know it will be one day, but we don't know when it is. It may be multiple generations down the road from where we are right now. But however long in the future that it is, Christ is still going to exist as a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. If we had to sum it up, we would have to say that Jesus is everything for us. There are people today that search to fill these voids in their life. Things that they look for to send them joy or to provide peace in their life. And they search the world over trying to find them. And yet Jesus is everything. Today I would ask, are we as a church or we as church people in need of correction in our hearts? Do we need Christ to enter our heart and turn the tables over and prevent us from walking through the temple? Are we trying to use the temple in a way that it was never meant to be used? In other words, are we taking advantage of grace? We're walking in the doors today and we're saying, praise God, His grace is sufficient in my life. It's covered my sin. It's paid the debt. I can live now in the freedom. And then we walk out the door and we pick up all of our burdens and all of our cares and we carry them with us all week and we don't turn them over to God and we think that we can handle them better than what He can. And so, number one, we deprive Him of the glory because we don't tell Him He is sufficient in our life. And number two, we're making our life so much harder. Because we can live in the peace that no matter what's going on in our life, God has got it covered. So are we trying to use the temple in a way? Are we trying to use Christ in a way that it was never meant to be used? And are we taking advantage of what He's done for us? That death upon the cross paid the debt of sin that you and I have eternally. But are we taking advantage of that to the point that we are abusing it? By claiming that grace, but then walking out into the world and acting no different than the rest of the world? And then coming back in whenever we meet again together and saying, praise the Lord, Christ has delivered me from my sin, and then walking right back out in the world and doing the same things all over again. I'm not saying we'll be perfect. What I'm saying is we should strive to grow more like Christ. And if we're not, then are we taking advantage of what Jesus done for us? In other words, are we viewing Jesus as a get-out-of-jail-free card? Or are we seeing Him as the only way, the way that God sent for salvation, the way for God to reunite with all those that He created? You see, our purpose must be pure. We must realize that Jesus died so that we could commune with God, so that salvation could occur to all who call upon the name of the Lord. Tonight, when we observe communion together, we are remembering all that Jesus represents, all that He is doing, all that He has done for us. The bread representing the body that is being has been broken for us. The juice representing His blood that had been spilled for us. When we come together, we're remembering all that He done, all these things that we've talked about this morning, cleansing the temple, cleansing our heart. We're remembering all of those actions that Christ has done. Could we say today that Jesus is everything in our life? Or are we in need of reevaluating our purpose? When people look at our life, do they see a connection to God? Or do they see money changers who are fulfilling God's purpose? Money changers who are not fulfilling God's purpose nor living their created purpose. What does the world see in us today as we stand together and go to the Lord in prayer? Musicians, come for our invitation this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today thanking you for this day. And Lord, thanking you for all that you have done through your Son for our benefit. And Lord, today we hope that in some way we have given you glory for that today. But Lord, also we hope that your word has challenged our hearts, knowing that you desire for our heart to be pure, just as the temple was, as a place where we commune with you. And Lord, today, if our heart is not pure in that way, Lord, we pray that we would be obedient and that we would allow you to turn over those money-changing tables within us. Lord, if we need to reevaluate where our life is with you in relationship, Lord, then convict us today of those times, and those events, those actions in our life that you would have us to turn away from. Lord, we do thank you that you continue to work within our life. But Lord, let us not take advantage of the many opportunities you give us by failing to act upon your guidance and your leading even now in our life. Lord, if there's one here who does not know you, we pray that today they would make that decision. Lord, that your conviction would be ever strong within their life, to where they would know that they need you as their Savior in order to have that relationship with God the Father. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done, all that you continue to do through your Son, Jesus Christ, as that high priest for us. And we pray these things in your Son's name, Jesus the Christ. Amen. As we sing a verse of invitation this morning, you're going to be singing the song, Nothing But the Blood. As you sing those words, I want you to think about all that Jesus has done for you. And there is nothing but the blood that could have paid the price for the debt that we had of sin. So as we sing this song, dwell upon Jesus being everything for your life. And if you have the need to come this morning, we invite you to come as we sing. As they continue to play for a moment, we're going to sing a second verse. You just sang the words, nothing but the blood. I think in our world we try to use a lot of different things to make us right with God. We try to say if we read our Bible enough, then everything will make us, then it will make us okay. If we go to church enough, then it will make us okay with God. If we do good things for other people enough, it will make us okay with God. And yet the words you just sang shows there is nothing but the blood that can make us okay with God. So I would ask you today, is that blood covering your sin and your life today? Or have we presumed upon the graciousness of God to the point that we've said, I'll take the blood, but I'll also take the world? See, God never says it's the blood plus something else. It's nothing but the blood. Today, if you lean on anything else, I would ask you as we sing the second verse to change and to lean only upon God today as we sing.
Thank you.
Let's be faithful to lift each other in prayer through all kinds of circumstances. A lot of prayer needs throughout the church. A lot of individuals that are still dealing with, Miss Ivana Presley is still dealing with trying to recover from the COVID and its after effects. So let's keep her in prayer. We've had some that have had surgeries. Miss Marcia Robinson was able to be in church with us this morning for the first time in over a month, I know. And thankfully, she's recovering from her knee replacement. But let's be faithful to remember them in prayer. I do have a card that I want to share from her. It says, I want to thank my church family for your prayers, cards, and food during the time I've been sick and my knee surgery. I appreciate all you have done. Thanks so much. And it's signed, Marcia Robinson. And so let's be faithful to continue to remember her as well as others as well. I want to share with you just a couple of announcements before we go concerning tonight especially. We will meet in the worship center tonight at 6 o'clock, so there will not be anything going on in here. We'll all meet in there, and it will be our communion service. We're not doing foot washing, just be communion, but we will gather and have that service this evening at 6 o'clock. Next Sunday is Easter, so in relation to that, we will have both services as we've been having, 9:30 and 11. But we will have children's church, toddler church, and nursery in both of those services. So next Sunday, we'll offer them both times. We will also go to a face covering or mask optional next Sunday from that point going forward. And we will have one section, probably this section, that will not be socially distanced. So we'll leave these three sections socially distanced, but we'll probably take the chairs out of this one. We'll have greeters posted at the door just to let you know where those sections are next Sunday. Next Sunday evening, we will not have our evening service. We will dismiss that in lieu of you hopefully spending the time with family, but thinking about what Christ done and his glorious resurrection. So we would ask that you keep that in mind. We will have our Wednesday Bible studies at 10 and 7. And we want to encourage you, if you've not been to a Wednesday evening Bible study in a while, we want to encourage you to come. We have a lot of good discussion that occurs there. It's not just me talking the whole time, but a lot of people are speaking up and discussing, and so we're thankful for that. And we want to encourage you to come and just be a part of that together. If you have any questions about it, please let me know. We want to thank those who participated in the blood drive. We had 30 usable units that were collected this past week, which went above what our previous number was, so we're thankful for that. And if I understood right, that can affect somewhere around 75 different lives. So that is a wonderful thing to be able to do. And then World Missions Offering, April 25th, a month from today. And we have a church goal of 12,000, but with your help and the government's, we'll be able to go to 20 if you would like. So just kind of be in prayer about that and see what God would want you to do with that. I do want to mention this as well. We do have some that are coming back that haven't been in a while, so this is just kind of an informational message as well. If you notice, we don't pass a plate in taking up offering anymore. I had never thought about this at all, but the offering plate is probably the thing that gets touched the most within the church. So we went to offering boxes. If you look by the doors as you leave, there's a box by each door. Those are the place that we put offering. If you want to give to World Missions Offering or the Youth Fund or whatever you want to give to, just note that on your check or on an envelope if you're doing cash, and Ms. Jennifer Rogers will make sure it goes to the right place. But those offering boxes are there, and they're available anytime if you would like to use them. So the thing we would ask concerning offering is do remember that is what we are giving back to God. It was His to begin with. He's given it to us. We're returning to Him what is rightfully His. But we would ask that you spend time in prayer about that. Normally, when we took up offering here in service, we would have a time of prayer before we took the offering up. We want to ask you to continue to do that. It's on your own, but continue to do that. And maybe you do it at home before you come to church. Gather the family around, pray about what you're giving. It's a great way to train the next generation. Let them know why you're doing it, and let them know that it was God's before it was yours. And then have that prayer, and then participate in giving to see evangelism occur not only here but throughout the world. Any questions about church-related stuff? All right, if you would stand with me again together, we're going to dismiss a little bit different this morning. I want to dismiss by singing the first verse and chorus to that second song, Glory to His Name. Hopefully, as we've went through today, you've been able to say that Jesus is worth being glorified. And so let's sing that song and keep that in mind as we go out today, that we need to bring glory to His name in all that we do. So let's sing that together.